Good morning. I think what that just means is I've been around a long time. We're going to take about 45 minutes and rapidly go through 30 years of, 30 years of my thoughts on the use of endovascular care for trauma. It's the past, it's our present, it's your future. And I think that this is going to be yet another huge paradigm shift, to use a term that's used too much. And so we will start with a real case that I took care of about 3 weeks ago, or we took care of. It's a 26-year-old kid. He comes in with a gunshot wound to the left back, out the right upper quadrant. He's got a blood pressure of 90, a heart rate of 105. Respiratory rate of 20, his belly's a little big, he's mildly tender. We read the literature, he gets no crystalloid, he only gets blood. And after a unit of blood, he is rock stable and as fast as positive in two quadrants of his abdomen. And so conventional wisdom says you take that patient in the operating room and you fix him, and we don't do that. Contemplating the ability to treat all or part of his injuries with endovascular care, he gets a CT scan that shows a huge pseudoaneurysm and a disrupted gastroduodenal artery and an arterial venous fistula with his portal vein, a narrowing of his inferior vena cava, a huge amount of blood in his abdomen. There's the big pseudoaneurysm again. Now, what we did, what we do today, is he had a laparotomy, we ligated his GDA, we repaired the cava, repaired the SMV. The porta explodes. The guys that were there tell me that they repaired the portal vein, which I think is French for it was bleeding like crazy. They threw some stitches in there until the bleeding stopped. And they said, well, I think we fixed it. They packed and went to angiography, where there was persistence of this huge pseudoaneurysm between his branch of his hepatic artery and his portal vein. And so we stack a whole bunch of coils. We take them back. We unpack them. The artery persists. The pseudoaneurysm persists. So we stick his liver, get into his portal vein, put a guide wire down his portal vein, switch that for a catheter, switch that for a 12 French sheath, and put a stent into the portal vein pseudoaneurysm. And there's the completion studies with many coils. The kid goes back to the operating room, has his abdomen closed. He goes home in about a week and a half. He did very well. What will we do next week, next year? We'll stick in the reboa. We'll leave the balloon down. We'll go to the hybrid suite. We'll not operate on this kid. We'll do an angiogram. We'll embolize the arterial side of the AV fistula. We'll do a venogram. We'll stent the cava. We'll do a transjugular approach to the portal vein, do a TIPS, get a catheter in, stent the portal vein, stick a laparoscope in, and the guy will go home in 3 days and do very, very well. That's where we're going. And how do we get there? This is 1984 in Brooklyn as I start my career, and I was immediately bitten by the power of endovascular care for injury. And one of my heroes, a guy named Jerry Shafton, then at that time in 1986, told us all to stop fighting about, I know the residents in the room will be, including my nephew, will be shocked to realize that I actually did practice medicine before the days of CT scanning. Not everybody died. And back then, the fight was, is CT better than DPL? And we're not any smarter than we were then. Now we just fight about something else. Is CTA better than a catheter study? They're different studies. We should use them. for what they're good for. Now, the first mention in the literature I can find of the use of endovascular care for trauma is this. It's 1972. It's remarkable for a couple of things. The first is it's in the New England Journal of Medicine, a journal that can't spell trauma, and it's from the Massachusetts General Hospital, an institution that until about 6 years ago couldn't spell trauma. And the last thing is it is three case reports about using pelvic embolization or pelvic angiography to identify pelvic bleeding in patients with blunt trauma. Now, you think about sending three case reports to the New England Journal in 2015, and you couldn't hit the send button before you get the reject notice back. But back then, this was apparently big news. And they say arterial bleeding from pelvic fractures may be more common than has been previously reported. Localization with angiography will improve selection for patients to have surgery for pelvic hemostasis, what we would consider, you know, not current care. But pelvic embolization made a lot of sense, because if you've ever done a laparotomy and opened the pelvic hematoma, the rest of the day goes downhill pretty quickly, and the patient then exsanguinates. And so the idea of using coils made some sense. But since back then we operated for diagnosis in the abdomen, the idea that we would use coil embolization anywhere else made no sense at all. But then CT replaced exploration other than patients in shock. And so we explored with a scan. We did therapy directed for particular injuries. And this is Sal Sclafani and Jerry Shafton. Dr. Shafton, I mentioned before, Dr. Sclafani, the other Italian from Brooklyn. And the three of us would sit and talk about how we would do things. And this is the way it came down. We said, well, you ought to do a screening test. Back then it was DPL, because Dr. Shafton in 1960 made us all recognize that physical exam is not that good. So based on mechanism, you ought to do a screening test. Now it's ultrasound. And if that makes you suspicious, you ought to do an organ-specific test. That's CT scan. But if you want to do a test that asks, is the patient bleeding, other than clinical exam, that's angiography. And so you should stack the tests one on top of the other. And even today, CT scan, a wonderful diagnostic test, it's a static set of images. And you take a static set of images and apply it to a dynamic situation, and you make a lot of bad decisions. Now, we believed that we could use this elsewhere in the abdomen, and the first place we went to is the spleen. And we began a protocol that you see up here, so everybody that came in with a CT-proven splenic injury got an angiogram. If it was negative, you got observed. If it was positive, you got coil embolization. This is the first series. It was published in 95. It is still, in the literature, the best salvage rate of splenic injury with non-operative management ever published. It's 98.5%. And it worked. Now, we presented it at East in 1994. The result, the discussion was animated. It wasn't particularly complimentary, as I recall, as even then, right? Not even 20 years ago, people thought we were children of the devil for the idea that we would actually put a coil into a blood vessel other than in the pelvis. And this is the way it goes. You catheterize the splenic artery, you measure it, same technique we use today. You put a coil in that's just a little too big so it doesn't migrate. There's the coil. There's the repeat angio. The splenic artery is occluded. Look at that. That's 7/13/1984. This is the early ones. And you think that that's a normal splenic angiogram because you can't see the coil. But this is the post-embolization study, and all of those little blood vessels are the collateral flow through the pancreas. That's how the spleen stays alive. And there have now been multiple studies that have clearly demonstrated that splenic artery angiography and embolization is very rational therapy, including a recent series that has a 1.5 failure rate in high-grade splenic injuries. It works. And so this concept of late or delayed splenic rupture is a misnomer. It's just that you didn't know that the patient had a vascular injury. And like any other vascular injury, if you don't treat it, it speaks back to you. Now, having decided that this was rational therapy in the spleen, we said, can we use it other places? And we began to look at the liver. And it's a different discussion, right? Because if you fail in the spleen, you take the spleen out. It's no big deal. If you fail in the liver, that's a little bit more complicated because people bleed to death. And as we evolved these concepts of damage control, we were in New York, we were one of the first groups to embrace surgery, embolization, more surgery, maybe more embolization, as a good way to take care of the injured liver. This is a shock trauma CT scan. This is early after I got there. It was around 2000. These were a 15 and a 16-year-old girl driving home from high school when their, Hyundai, VW, some small car met an 18-wheeler on Route 95. That didn't work out quite so well for the small car. And they both came in. Her sister was actually in profound hemorrhagic shock. One of my partners, Jim Hahn, took her to the operating room, called me, said I could use some help. She actually avulsed her middle hepatic vein off her cava. By the grace of God, we got her fixed. And he said, would you take a look at her sister before you leave? I went out, and the TRU Bay 5, I'll not ever forget this. She comes back, and the nurse, who's currently one of our nurse practitioners, says, the CT scan does not look too good. And I looked at this. This is an early scan, so not a. This was like a four-slice scanner. And I looked at those. Well, you say, all right, that's a right hepatic lobectomy all the way down to the cava to fix that. So I looked at her, and she had a blood pressure of about 80, and her belly was all blown up. And I said, that's not going to work too well, because if I do that, she's going to bleed to death and going to die. I didn't know what hypotensive resuscitation was, but I said, you know, she doesn't look so bad. 80 is probably okay, so we'll just leave her be. Don't make her blood pressure any higher. And I walked over to the angio suite, and the guys were finishing the spleen. I said, how about you not go home? There's her angiogram. There were four vascular injuries that size. So this is heresy, right? I just took a hypotensive trauma patient with hemoperitoneum to the angio suite. We knocked off all of those. There's her angiogram. I take her to the operating room. We decompress her because she's now got compartment syndrome. We pack her liver. We take her back to the angio suite. Excuse me. We'll just do it that way. We take her back to the angio suite. Be sure she's hemostatic. I bring her back the next day, do a right hepatic lobectomy. She recovers. She thinks this is fun. She goes to nursing school. She becomes a nurse practitioner, and I hire her because finding, you know, we'll do a lot to recruit good nurse practitioners. And so, but I've never forgotten flipping it and doing it backwards, right? Made some sense. Now, the more we did this, the more sense it made. And then one of my fellows came up and said, can I take a look at these? Sure. Go knock yourself out. And she and Deb Stein, my chief of trauma, did that. And they came and said, you know, the complication rate's very high. from angioembolization. I said, oh, come on, it's not. And those of you that know Dr. Stein, in her own inimitable way, said, well, if you're so damn smart, you go look at the data. Oh, complication rate was pretty high. It's 43%. And it's major hepatic necrosis. Why is that? Well, I think it's because they're really badly hurt, and we pack the liver and compress it. We take the portal vein circulation out that way. We then embolize the arterial side. The liver dies. Is that bad? Well, it's not great, but the patient's alive. So maybe it's okay. All right, so this becomes the next generation of damage control. All right, pack the liver, do the embolization, go. All right, there's the CT scan, there's the angiogram, there's the dead liver. What's the answer to that? It's a liver resection. So we began doing urgent but not emergent right hepatic lobectomies for this. There's the specimen. Doesn't look very good, does it? There's the cut edge of the liver. And you know, we wanted to be good stewards of the technique, so we looked at the first 30, 16 hepatic lobes versus, you know, I don't know, let's go in and pick away at it and stick a drain in it. And it turned out hepatic lobectomy was at least as good as picking at it. And that's now become the way we do things. As we began to embrace this some more, we said, how about instead of embolization, how about stent grafting of injuries? And the first place we went to was the aorta. This is, as we call it, AAST2. The first series was 97, where everybody was done open. This is the first big multi-institutional trial of aortic stent grafting. It was written by Dimitri Dimitriadis, George Velmahos, and me. It was 18 centers over 26 months. It's 200 patients. About 40% came from three places, Baltimore, L.A., and Harborview. So it's kind of front-loaded with three places, and you can see, but now two-thirds are managed with a stent, only a third are done open, and there is a highly statistically significant mortality advantage to stent grafting. You know, I understand it's another perfectly good operation that just went away. It's 7% and 23%. Would you rather be in the 7% group or the 23% group? I think that's pretty clear. Now, we could, because we're arrogant, we said it must be because us three are so much better than everybody else, right? That made sense. Except it wasn't true, because when we split this by volume of center, everybody did well. It had nothing to do with the high-volume centers or the low-volume centers. The bad news is that, you know, the devices weren't made for young aortas. And so there's about a 20% device-related complication, mostly endoleak. Now, you can fix those, but it's still a complication. This is our series. It's still the largest single-institution series of aortic stent grafts. And we were a little better. We were 14 instead of 20, but still not that great. Now, everybody has figured out that this is going to be an industry, and so Gore is now making a new, everybody has got a new one. They're all in trials, and so this will likely go away. But here is the evolution. Well, we now have, Joe Rabin from our shop came up with a shock trauma grading system for aortic injuries. This is the last 97 we did. He published this 2013, 2014. And what you see is about 35% of aortic injuries get nothing now. They get treated with beta blockers. We have yet to have one progress. That's better. We said that one of the absolute indications for early stent grafting was brain injury, right? So that you wouldn't have to drop the blood pressure, beta block them, and there would be no blood loss. So it's not like you have to put a cross clamp on the aorta in the patient with a bad brain injury. It turned out we were once again wrong, and you can see at the bottom of the slide, early stent grafting was associated with a significant, highly statistically significant, worsening of the brain injury, which makes no sense to me at all. This is Don Harris's work that we just published. And so, go figure. I don't get it. But it seems real to me, 34% versus 0%, which mirrored the AAST data. And so, maybe it should be beta blocker for 3 days followed by stent grafting. We're still working on it. And the last thing that we realize with the aortas is, you know, everybody is a catheter jockey now. The cardiologists, the IR guys, the vascular guys, the cardiac guys, because, oh my God, it's the aorta. You can't touch that without us being there. And it turned out that the more people we had do it, the more complications we had. So we solved that by sending everybody else away. And when we did the first series, Dave Neshes did every one of those by himself. We are now down to a 2- or 3-person group, and the complications have gone away. It's not about can you stick a stent in. It's about do you understand the patients? Do you understand the disease? And then can you stick a stent in? And this is, I always love this case. This is a 50-year-old guy came into the TRU after a high-speed vehicular crash with, and I know this would never happen at a place as sophisticated as the University of Wisconsin, but one of our residents decided that when I turned my back to put a central line in for reasons that are completely unclear to me, and put the line in his groin and hit the artery. And using perfect resident logic, said, well, I'm in the artery, I might as well put an art line in, right? So stuck a femoral arterial line in. The guy's blood pressure was 70. He didn't look that sick, but he had a positive fast, so I took him to the operating room and took his spleen out, and his blood pressure was 70. So, well, he had a normal chest x-ray. We got another chest x-ray. It's normal. I said, that doesn't make much sense. So I said, we're going to leave him open, take him over to the scanner, you know, the scanner where all truth is revealed, and give me a call. I'm going to go upstairs to the office and push some papers. And the beeper went off. It was the TRU. I said, okay. And my fellow was hyperventilating. And I said, Ali, please stop talking. If you know Ali, you know that's very hard for him to do. And so I said, please stop talking, and you can tell me one sentence. And he says, the radiology attending just called me and asked me if the patient was still alive. Oh, that's bad. So I went down, and here's why the guy's femoral blood pressure has got pseudo-coarctation of his aorta from a huge posterior rupture of his aorta just above his celiac axis. Well, that's a problem, because his celiac's injured, his SMA doesn't look so good. And I said, boy, that's going to be hard, right? That's a thoracoabdominal. His abdomen's already open. We're going to put a graft in a contaminated field. He's going to get a graft infection. He's going to die. This is all a mess. So I said, boy, I wonder if we get a stent in that. Doesn't look like you can, but I said, what the hell, we'll try. So we did, and we got a stent in just above the celiac. This is the first case report of stent grafting in the aorta other than by the left subclavian. And this has now become our, we've now done about a half a dozen or 10 penetrating injuries to the aorta with stent grafting down by the celiac. It works great. Works great. Now, every time somebody comes to tell me they have a new idea, I smile. It's a very, very grainy picture because it's a 1989 issue of the Journal of Trauma. They said, we've got this cool idea. We think we can use balloons for proximal aorta control. I said, boy, that's great. I bet nobody's thought of that before. Oh, that's our article in 89 talking about balloon occlusion for proximal control. There's the proximal left subclavian artery injury. There's the balloon with the dye in it and we reported on about a half a dozen or 10 people, and they all got their subclavians fixed through 5-inch periclavicular incisions because we used the balloon for proximal control. And this is really about creating a cocoon, a safe place for the patient. And in our shop, when I was in Brooklyn and we had Sal, the IR suite was an ICU room. It just had a big X-ray machine in it. And if you visit shock trauma, you realize that the interventional radiology suite is in the emergency department, or our version of an ED. And that's immediately adjacent to the operating room. So they're 10 feet. 10 feet from IR to ER, ER to OR1. And so it allows us to do some things that not everybody can do. But it seems to me that we have been held hostage. We were talking about this yesterday. I was with the residents. Because in Maryland, the interventional radiologists have the keys to the interventional radiology suite. And so I asked the CEO of the hospital, how come? How come I can't have a set of keys? He said, well, that's their place. I said, really, did they pay for it? Like, did they have a bake sale and buy the angio machine? I don't get it. And he said, well, you know, Tom, no, I actually don't know, but okay. And we invent workarounds like extra peritoneal pelvic packing because we can't do what we really want to do quickly, which is to embolize the pelvis. So, I mean, why would you want to open the pelvic hematoma and shove a bunch of dirty rags in there to stop hemorrhage? Oh, guess what? The best reported series has a 25% incidence of pelvic abscess. Go figure. Why is that a good idea? It's not. And, you know, I don't know where your interventional radiologists are, but at 2 a.m., mine are not in the hospital. And they're incredibly talented guys. And they're not, I don't mean to say that I think they're lazy, because they're not. You call them, they come. But they have an hour to set up the angio suite. That's the policy. And by God, the attending's not going to come in until the room's ready. And so rapid access to the IR suite's 2 hours. If you really, like, look at the clock and write the time down. Well, that's not very good for a patient in shock. So here's our new solution. It's our hybrid operating room. I think it's, well, I actually know I measured it. This is bigger than my first studio apartment in New York City, the hybrid room. It's the truth. It's huge. It's got all sorts of stuff. I don't even know what all that stuff is. And the thing that changes the game now is the ability to do rapid balloon occlusion of the aorta. The ROBOA, as we have called it, or as it has been called, is transfemoral occlusion of the aorta to get absolute inflow control. Here is the sheath. It's placed via a standard femoral art line. You put the catheter in, you take the Amplatz guide wire, you put the guide wire in, you take the catheter out. You take the sheath that I just showed you. It's a big sheath. It's 12 French. And you put the 12 French sheath into the iliac. You leave the guide wire in. You take the balloon catheter, you put the balloon catheter in. You blow up the balloon. You now have inflow control wherever you want it. And then you can confirm position by putting some contrast in the balloon and getting an X-ray. You can do it with fluoroscopy. You can do it with ultrasound if you're any good with the ultrasound probe. You can put it in percutaneously. I frankly prefer to put it in via cutdown. And the way I do it is I make a cut in the groin. I get down to the common. You have to put it in the common. If you put it in the SFA, you tear the SFA because it's too big. So I take a clamp. I put it under the common femoral artery, and I just pull the clamp up. So now I've altered the angle of the femoral artery so I can hit it at a much more gentle angle rather than going in percutaneously and doing that. And then I just put it in. And you got to fix the artery anyhow, so why not open the groin early? It makes sense to me. I love this. You know, shock trauma has more resources than God, I think. And so when we decided to employ this, what we did, I said, here, we need this to be able to be accessible quickly. So what did nurses do? They went and got a patient belonging bag, and they shoved our high-tech stuff into the bag, and it just sits on the wall in a patient bag. It's the 50-cent solution in the million-dollar hospital. It's great. There it is, TRU Bay 1. That's where the Reboa sits. And this is Megan Brenner, who's done all our work. This is her algorithm for where you put it. Zone 1, Zone 2, Zone 3. Now, once again, there's nothing new here. This was first described in 54 by Hughes in the Korean War. It didn't work too well because he waited until the patients were essentially dead. And as a last-ditch effort, he put in a balloon. So it didn't work, but he at least three patients. But he published the concept. You can see it. Kind of a crude balloon. Ron Lowe, one of my old faculty members, very small series. Jerry Shafton back in 89 when he was at Brookdale, had a 35% survivor. This is the first kind of series. In France, looking at pelvic fractures, they had in-house interventional radiology people to put these in with pretty good survival. This is the first of the really modern series. It's Megan's series. She published a year and a half ago. It's the first six patients. There are a couple of things that you can see. One is that they're pretty much all banged up. Secondly, is four of the six are blunt trauma. Last, you can see that four of the six have the Reboa put in as a bridge to embolization. And nobody bled to death. Pretty good. There it is. The Reboa is in the left groin. We're in the abdomen. This was put in preoperatively. And so, how do you make this work? Well, the only way you make it work is if you have in-house people that can put this in. Because you can't wait for the consultant to come in to put it in. So how do you do that? Well, in my shop, it's the trauma guys are there. But other people have trained emergency physicians, anesthesiologists. It's just a big art line. I mean, I can train the residents to do that. I can train anybody to do this. And so how do we train? How do you get privileges? How do you maintain competence? Incredibly important things. And if we're going to do this, we have to benchmark our results against the experts because we got to be as good as they are. That's just the way it is. This is, we've had a very nice collaboration with some guys in Japan. This is they're 10 years ahead of Americans with this. And this is their course. So I sent Megan, June, my colleague in Japan, June from Japan, because I can't pronounce his last name, said, we got this course. So I said, Megan, here, I'll buy you an airplane ticket, go to Tokyo, take the course, come back and teach us. There it is. There's their simulator. Looks kind of funny, but it's a pretty good simulator. It feels real when you put the balloon in and everything else. And then, so I said, where are the pictures? And she said, they're on the camera. So I started flipping through the camera. I saw that one. And that doesn't look, maybe that's the outside of the place where they did the course, right? Apparently, I sent her to Japan to eat sushi and drink sake. I didn't realize that's what I had done. The guy in the back across from her is June. An unbelievably talented guy. There is their algorithm for balloon occlusion. I got non-responder. That's all I get out of that. And what Megan did is she brought everybody, you know, all you guys know we wear the pink scrubs, so she bought everybody a pair of pink scrubs. This is what June wrote back. Hello, Megan, Dr. Brenner. I thank you very much for your kindness. I'll tell you about Presto here in a second. I use the shock trauma scrubs. When I put them on, I feel so strong, I can be very aggressive. And they have employed damage control in the IR suite. So they have in-house emergency physicians that are cross-trained as interventional radiologists. The sheath goes in when the patient comes in. They're in the interventional suite in 15 minutes. They get the CT scan on the angio table. So they're putting the catheter in while they get the images. It's 15 minutes per artery embolized. So in an hour, they do a pelvis, a spleen, a liver, and an intercostal artery. For them, shock, they can be get this done faster than they get in the operating room. Shock is an indication, not a contraindication, for the use of catheter therapy. This is the first of their, not the first, this is their most recent publication, and this is seven patients had the Reboa put in, came in shock, and got taken to the angio suite. Six of seven lived. Pretty good. New way of thinking about it. What I asked Megan to do, I said, we got to fix this. You know, we got to teach people. We got to teach them our way. So this is our course, Basic Endovascular Skills for Trauma. It's a combination simulator. It's a little fancier than the Japanese simulator. It's the Mentis simulator. And then she went out and spent some time with the guys at LA County and came back and has created a perfused cadaver model that we now use for the course. That would be the cadaver lab. The cadaver has a blood pressure. And you got to fix the artery. If you don't put the balloon in correctly, the blood pressure doesn't go up. Feels pretty real. And it's better than anything else because it's real human anatomy. The big animals, the anatomy is no good. So I said, you need to teach it, and then you need to report on it. So this is our most recent publication on the course. You can, it's the first 13 people we taught. It's our faculty. It's a mishmash. If you knew my faculty, you would know that was true. You could see that there was one person fresh out of training, one person 17 years out. The guy that's 17 years out had done a cardiac fellowship. So he was pretty facile with these balloon things. And he had put in a bunch of, you know, balloon pumps. And so can we train? And we had two emergency physicians in the group that are on the faculty. That's the procedure time. It plateaus at six. So that's what we said. You can do six. You have to show that you have become facile to pass the course. And now, if you want privileges at the Shock Trauma Center to put this in, you either have to come show me your credentials, like Jim O'Connor that was the cardiac surgeon. Oh, you get privileges because you're Jim O'Connor. But if you're not him or me, you got to show me the certificate that says you took the course, or you don't get to put it in. That's the way it is. We have really sort of cornered this. That's Megan with the black hat on and Melanie Hain. And what we did is we took two people and said, you want to do trauma interventional? That's a big part of your practice. They said, love to. And so we've created our own vascular intervention service that uses the hybrid room that doesn't need the keys to unlock the IR suite. This is what we just sent to the AAST. We've done 50 cases in 5 months. That included the ramp-up period, so it'll be 150 a year. That's where we're going to get to. First 50, no procedural complications. One person developed a new pseudoaneurysm in the pelvis that required coiling, but there were no procedural complications, including 4 T-VARs, 11 pelvises, 5 spleens, and a bunch of venous stuff. And, we did a common carotid stent. We did a celiac stent. We've embolized a lumbar, a bronchial artery, and a profunda branch. They're really pretty slick. They're really pretty good. They're really there in 20 minutes. And so a couple, where do we really use it? This is sort of another case. This is a 63-year-old Marine, got hit by a car, gets intubated in the field. He's got an AP compression pelvic fracture. There's the ROBOA inserted into zone 3. He's completely stable. There's the sheath in the left. We use the left groin because we want to leave the right groin to embolize the pelvis. We take him to the CT scanner with the balloon up. He's fine. We're setting up the hybrid room. There's no problem here. Scan his chest. Be sure he doesn't have, you know, this, that, or something else. He goes over to the angio suite. Hybrid room. He gets his pelvis embolized. We're right there. We take the catheter out. We fix his femoral artery. He went home in about a week. There's his bilateral SI joint disruption. Now, I was at the Western Trauma last year, and that's Gene Moore. Anybody that knows trauma knows that Gene Moore is larger than life, and he got up at the Western Trauma and said, ROBOA is a technique looking for an indication. This is for people that can't actually do real surgery. So the EM guy's there. There's Dr. Moore at Denver General. There he is doing an emergency department laparotomy to occlude the aorta in a young kid with a pelvic fracture. I said, Gene, is that really a good idea? I mean, I understand you're using the finest universal precautions here, but that's really the way we want to do this? And apparently, 3 weeks later, somebody came up and said, is that what you were looking for? So I have to give credit to Gene. He sent me these pictures a few weeks ago. And he got up at the Western Trauma this year and insisted that ROBOA be part of the algorithm for pelvic fracture hemorrhage. Okay. Still the same good universal precautions. At least this time he had sterile gloves on. This is the other common indication for us. This is a young guy that came in after a low-speed motorcycle crash. I couldn't understand why he was so sick. The only thing that made my epinephrine levels higher than his when I walked over to the bed and realized he was one of my faculty members with a blood pressure of 60. And what he's done is ruptured a huge AV malformation in the right lobe of his liver. So I take him to the operating room, and he is bleeding like stink. And you can see back there, that's a long way back there, and the same thing. I said, boy, he's going to die. That's bad. I'm going to have to, like, recruit a replacement. It's all very bad. So I put the ROBOA in him, blew it up, took him to the angio suite. There's the AV malformation. Embolized it, took him back, embolized him again. Liver died, did a right hepatic lobectomy. And there is Alex on his first day back to work. We were very happy to see him come back. Now, what about using the ROBOA instead of ED thoracotomy? Two series. This is the first from last year. This is UT Houston in shock trauma. You see over the 18-month period, we've not stopped doing. We do a lot less ED thoracotomies. The survival rate for the ROBOA, highly statistically significantly better than the resuscitative thoracotomy. I understand they're not the same patients. Maybe. They kind of look the same. This is what we just sent to the AAST this year. This is 118 aortic occlusions, either the ROBOA or open, 8 medical centers, prospective data, and what you can see is that the ROBOA is at least as good as ED thoracotomy. In some ways, maybe better. And we always say that the reason you have to open the chest is because open cardiac massage is better than closed chest massage in a patient that's exsanguinated. We say that because we know it's true. Of course, we never actually tested it, but we knew it was true. And so we just tested it. This is our data we just sent to the AAST. We have the ability in the resuscitation unit to measure vital signs every 6 seconds, including end-tidal CO2. So this is the first 35 people that came in with cardiac arrest. We looked at end-tidal CO2 with closed chest massage and open chest massage, and it turns out they're exactly the same. Survival no different. Oh, so maybe the REBOA and closed chest cardiac massage, if you have a negative pericardial fast, is as good as ED thoracotomy. I frankly think it is. So, and here, this is another real case. Young kid came in. He had a trajectory we thought through his mediastinum. He arrested as he got there. We do a resuscitative thoracotomy thinking he's got a cardiac injury. He doesn't. What he's got is intra-abdominal hemorrhage. We get him back, and I hand the aorta cross clamp to my fourth-year resident from Walter Reed, pretty slick kid, and I said, put the cross clamp on. And I put the REBOA in, and before he got the cross clamp on, I had the balloon inflated. It's quicker if you know what you're doing. And so, and you can then pull the balloon down below the celiac, below the SMA. It's not an all or none thing. You can partially occlude as opposed to fully occluding. It's a good thing. Where are we going? This is the new Japanese balloon. It's a 9 French, not a 12 French. This has gone across. This is the Royal London Hospital. There's this bright yellow. This is the first case report of roadside placement of the REBOA. It's in the field. We just trained the first 4 special forces medics for the Army. It's going into the field. Guess what? They're as good as the doctors. No big surprise. This is the brand new balloon. It'll be available in this calendar year. It's 7 French. There's no guide wire. You put a introducer into the femoral artery, you slide the balloon up, you blow it up. There is no creep with the balloon, at least in the animal studies. This is now a completely percutaneous procedure. All you do is push when you take the introducer out. This is going to be in skilled pre-hospital hands. We're gonna put it on our helicopters and give it to the paramedics. It's going to become part of the armamentarium of the emergency physicians in the referring hospitals. It's going to really go out and do it. Now, this is Nick Namias at the pelvic fracture algorithm. When he got up, he's from Miami, and he goes, I suppose some of you think we should put a REBOA in, go to the operating room, pack the pelvis, put a fixator on, do an angiogram, and embolize the pelvis, and have one group of surgeons do it all, but that's not reality. And I'm telling you, it is reality. It's reality in Baltimore, and it's going to be reality everywhere sometime in the next few years. And so I leave you with the thought that endovascular care is very much part of the present, and it will be part of the future. This is not a fad. This is the REBOA, in my mind, is a powerful tool. There are 1,000 questions. We just blew a bunch of cash and equipped a large animal lab to answer what's the flow patterns, how long can you leave it up. There are a million questions that we need to answer. And as far as I'm concerned, if we don't embrace this, us, the trauma, critical care, emergency care guys, however you want to define that, and if we are arrogant like we have been in the past and say, well, nobody can touch that except us, we will do the same thing we did with endovascular care. The cardiologist will do it, and everybody will do it, and they'll do it badly. We've already had, not in Maryland, but one person put a balloon up the aorta, blow it up, call the referring hospital, get a bunch of static from the senior resident, blah, 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 arrived at the referring hospital with the balloon up for 4 hours. You might guess that didn't work out too well. And the guy died of complete ischemia to his lower body. Now, if we don't train people, if we don't develop the courses, if we don't own this, then that's what's going to happen. And we can, you can stamp your feet and say it's not right, and you can stamp your feet and say it's not right, and it'll still happen. And in my mind, the future is in the room. I'm 63. I got a little bit of gas left in my tank, but I'm not the one that's going to go fix this problem. You guys are. And there is a huge opportunity. There's a career here in being the pioneer of endovascular care, of minimally invasive care in trauma. There's a whole opportunity here. And I hope that 20 years from now, wherever it is I am, that somebody wheels me out to the AAST and I can see you guys up there saying, this is the way that we do trauma 20 years after the old guy tried to teach us. I really appreciate the opportunity to come visit Joe. I appreciate the opportunity to come to Madison. I've had a great time, and I'm happy to answer questions if anybody has any.